I raise a hallelujah. So good morning to our online family, and what a blessing it is to be here again. For everybody who heard the song and you saw the involvement from all of our other families, I think if you weren't involved in that production and you'd still like to contribute, then raise a hallelujah in the comments. Hopefully you know how to spell it now, because I battle. But if you can't, just say an amen or a something there. It's great for us to be able to interact, especially for those who are joining on our new church online platform. And if you'd like to join, it's a very different experience, then please go along. We've got it in the comments below. The YouTube channel where you can go and join our church online. Same video, it's just a different frame, and it allows us to interact a lot better. So please, but thank you for joining us as we head into the colder months that are coming. Winter is on its way, and I'm sure you felt it. Apparently, there's going to be some snow next week on the mountains in Lesotho. So for those joining from Lesotho, blanket. But for the rest of us, we're still going to feel it. And we're going to Motherwell and seeing the need there. It's just, it's incredible. So we saw a teenage boy, maybe about my height, and he was wearing a St. Mark's grade R t-shirt that didn't quite get to his belt. And when you see that what we take as surplus, so we've got so much clothing in our cupboards that it's a nuisance because I can't find what I'm looking for, and you know, the stuff's pouring out. And then you see in that setting how it has value to them. To all the little boys who are wearing girls' shoes because it's the only shoes they have and they don't really care. But that value, and I want us to really make a difference. And so we are going to be putting together a program, and we want to share the warmth this winter. So we've asked some of our families for the children to start packing boxes and things that they might not need, clothing especially, or anything else, some toys. We're going to plan this very carefully, and we're going to give details as to how you are able to safely drop it off here at the church. We will then sanitize it completely so that we are keeping within the regulations, and then we're going to be able to distribute that to the families that really need it and that are going to make use of it. We did this last year as well. We asked you to clear out your cupboards, and it's just different because we have the opportunity of going to the shops now that they're open and buying more clothing for winter, you know, because the old, yeah, we don't want to wear the same stuff again. It's like, oh, shame. So we did this last year, and the response was so beautiful. This year, the need is there again, because for families who are battling to buy food, clothing is way down on the list. And if you are able to make a difference, I'm saying please, go to your cupboards, empty them out. You're doing yourself a favor, because decluttering is a really good thing as well. Bring it to us. We will make sure that everything is as it needs to be from the regulation standpoint, and then we will distribute that safely. So please, we will be in touch. Look at our Facebook page with details, and we'll put something on our website to explain exactly how we're going to do this in the next couple of weeks. But in the meantime, you can prepare your cupboards, get your clothing together, get the family involved, and we look forward to it being a great blessing.
Jesus wants us to love one another and be kind and to share. So this is what I'm going to share with people who don't got winter stuff. So I got some shoes. Got some more shoes. Then I got some pants. Some blankies, some pillows, some teddies, some jackets, some pajamas, some socks. Happy stable!
I'd also like to share that our Motherwell outreach has really been phenomenal. And our St. Mark's outreach team, along with our AXA team, have gone beyond expectations. We ran the first phase from the 20th of April to the 20th of May. It just so happened, and I promise you, we didn't plan it like this, that on the 20th of May, the last day of the first phase, was also our Motherwell Church's 8th birthday. And so we have some photographs of Pastor Ezra and his wife, Sumakazi, and the volunteers who had a little birthday cake, and we handed out some sweets along with the soup to the children. But over this month, we've seen an interesting trend. The first few weeks after the SASSA grants are distributed, the numbers drop to between 60 and 80 children that come along every day. And in the last 2 weeks, that number spikes to 150 little kids that come along every day for soup. And so that need is really there. But it's great to see that when the need is not there, they're not just coming along just because they want the soup. They come along because they genuinely are hungry. And so for those who have contributed, I want to give you a massive thank you. And you are making this possible. And we will continue this. We've moved into phase two, which is upskilling the community there. They've started making more of the soup in our little trailer, our outreach trailer, which has a gas hob. So they are making the soup there. And our outreach team and AXA team are going to shift their focus to see how they can impact in other ways. So the program is developing beautifully as we wanted it to. We come in, help initially, upskill, get the community to help, and then we can shift and help in other areas. But I'd also like to give a very big thank you. And that is to those who have given to our ministry. And I haven't been speaking about the giving, but I've looked at some of the numbers. And it's so beautiful to see, because without asking, without pushing, we have seen a 24% increase in our donation income. And I can't tell you what that does, because it's honestly not about the money. And I hope that you understand that. It's about you being able to see the need, and about you, instead of having a poverty mindset of I need to keep and keep and keep, of having that mindset of generosity. I also want to mention that we had a really special service, Bruce and I, on Thursday, which was Ascension Day, and it was fantastic to be able to share with Bruce. So if you haven't seen it, I really want to encourage you, especially for those who are battling during this time, and especially for those who have lost loved ones. It gets our attention back onto our hope and onto seeing our loved ones again and the purpose of our faith. So please go and have a listen. It's on our YouTube channel, and I'm sure that you will find great encouragement and inspiration from that. So this is our new series, Be Contagious, Stay Positive. A beautiful series straight from Life Church. They've been running this series a couple of weeks ago, and we're going to be following it because it's very apt to our times. And this first one that we're going to be looking at is Enough of the Bad News. So if you've ever been around someone with an infectious laugh, you'll know that it's contagious. So when they laugh, you can't help it. It's something about they laugh like from their tummy, like our little Sophia, and even Eva, and Georgia, and their mother. Like, I'm just around people that laugh like that. When they have that genuine laugh, it just makes you smile. So it's great to be around that. But it's not just your laugh that is contagious. So is your attitude. And the bad news is that negativity is caught more easily. And it sticks around for longer. And that's why we have to emphasize that we want to be contagious. But we want to be contagious about the right things. And when we speak about our attitude and we speak about how we're going to perceive the circumstances that we have, we want to have a godly perspective on that. So as believers, we have so many reasons to be positive, and we want that to be contagious. Sometimes we know that life just gets too much. You really battle. And when we're looking at our current circumstances, you get tired of all of the negativity around you. And maybe you feel like that. Maybe you feel that negativity around you is just too much. And that's why we get to this place where we say, enough of the bad news. We want to be able to reverse that. And when we reverse that, we look at some of the news that we are exposed to. People are dying, and that's a reality. We know that people are losing their jobs, and maybe this has affected you really personally. We also know that the economy is struggling, and we keep getting all of this bad, bad news. We loved our president's first 3 or 4 speeches. They were proper, and everybody was raving about it. And then the last one, then we're just like, yeah, that wasn't what we were expecting to hear. And you know what's really funny? It was easy when it wasn't difficult. Let me say that again. It was easy when it wasn't difficult. Now, we're sitting thinking, but this is the end of the world as we know it. And we're in this weird place of, what am I going to do? Am I going to try and just ignore everything and bury my head in the sand? Or am I going to join the noise of the revolt and make my negativity, my unhappiness known? And you know what happens is, it's very easy to get sucked in, to become unsettled and anxious, and to think, are we ever going to get back to normal? Emotionally, we get to that place where we're right on the edge, and small things start irritating us. And our fuse that was short is now even shorter, or maybe even non-existent. And we discouraged a whole lot more easily. So that it's just not the same. Life is never going to be the same. And we ask God to help us see the good in all of this bad. But we're not quite sure that it's going to happen. And that's where we've got to turn this around. And as believers, we have to start changing. We have to change our attitudes first. We have to start changing the way that we view this. And that's what this series is about. It's about us being positive. That something positive is going to come out of this. And we've got a list going. That list is about all of the things that we've learned during this time of lockdown. All of the things that have changed. So spending more time at home, bonding more with our children, the change in our priorities, the values now that we see that maybe we weren't as aware of. Something as simple as just being thankful for our basic freedoms. Those weren't there pre-lockdown, but all of a sudden, now they're right there. And we want to be able to look at that list and say, you know what, there is so much that we can be thankful for. I want us also to be wise, so please wash hands. We're going to stay our 1.5, 2 meters social distance. We're going to wear a mask in public, but we're also going to stay positive. We will do everything that is necessary. We're not going to ignore, but we are going to have a different mindset, an attitude of faith that says God is still at work. And that's the attitude that is going to carry us through. A negative outlook never leads to a positive life. So what we need is we need to be unshakably optimistic about the future. And that's our key thought for this series and specifically for today's message. And that's why the title of this morning's message is Enough of the Bad News. And before we get into this, I'm going to ask that we have a prayer. Father, we know that there are so many things that we can look at and think life needs to be different. But Father, I want to ask that we would not take on the thinking of this world, but that we would rather focus our minds on you. And as we head into this new series, Father, I pray that we would look to you for answers and that we would have that unshakable optimism that you are still at work, that you are still in control, that you are the God of all creation and all things, and that nothing is more powerful than you. And so, Father, I pray that we would hand over our fears and our anxieties to you, that we would hand over our future, our current situation to you, and that in your hands, you will do so much more with it than what we could ever imagine. And we pray that you would help us to see the positive things that you're doing in these difficult times. As we pray this in the name of our Savior, Christ Jesus. Amen. And everybody said, amen. And you can't really say it, so type it on the side and give us an amen. You know what we want to do is we want to look, if I'm saying be optimistic, there is a definition of optimism that I don't want you to have. And that is a definition that maybe Christians sometimes are accused of having. So I'm first going to define what optimism is not. Optimism is not a denial of reality, where we say, oh, don't worry, everything's good. You know what? This is not such a big deal. We must just be positive. That's not what it is. So the optimism that we're looking for is different. Optimism is also not blind faith, where it's just this naive hope and this wishful thinking. It's not a denial of reality or blind faith. Our Christian optimism is confidence about the future, about a successful outcome. Our Christian optimism is the unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our future good. And you know where that concept comes from? It comes from one of our favorite Bible verses. And we know this verse, we quote it a lot. And then when we get to difficult times, we forget it. And that's why we need to be reminded of these things constantly. So Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, we know that in all things, God works for the good to those who love him, to those who have been called according to his purpose. So God works together all things for the good. Yeah, but not this one. No, this one is bad. This one is really bad. And I don't know what it is that you've been facing during this time that has really got you down. That is, instead of you being optimistic and positive, you've shifted over to that side of negativity and pessimism. Maybe it's that you've had to deal with an impossible boss, an impossible company who've really handled the situation poorly. Maybe you've had your own personal financial setbacks. Maybe you've been stuck with annoying in-laws or locked up with a teenager for the whole of lockdown. Or worse, maybe you've been locked up with your parents as a teenager. Like, that could be bad, and I understand. Maybe you've been through a painful breakup, and you've been really hurt and betrayed and humiliated. Maybe you've had a loved one who has passed away recently, and you're battling to just cope with that, never mind with all of this. And as difficult as it is to believe that right now, in these circumstances, God is at work, because even a negative situation still holds the potential to produce a positive outcome. And that's why we have to have that unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our good. And when you really take a step back and you ask yourself, but why is it that I have this attitude? Why is it that I'm battling to be positive? Why is it that I'm not coping? Why is it that the situation is getting to me now? Like, it seems like it's so much bigger. And we have to stop, and you have to think about what you think about. Think about what you think about. And when you stop and you do that, just answer this one simple question. How do you see the future? How do you see this working out in the months and the years that lie ahead? And I can almost guarantee you that's where your problem lies. Because if your concept of the future, of what's going to happen, and you can't see anything good, you can't see anything positive in that future, it's going to overwhelm you right now. If your thoughts are consumed with negativity, with worry, and with fear, and with anxiety, and everything around you is just bad news, that's what you're thinking about. Because what consumes your mind controls your life. How is this true? So the person who has everything materially, but is miserable, versus the person with very little, but who's full of joy. How does it work? It's about the thinking. And it's not just about materially. What about the person who has so much going for them, so much potential, fantastic relationships, everything that they could need, but yet they're unhappy, compared to the person who's facing a massive personal crisis, yet they have peace and comfort? How do we get those two situations in the same world where logic and reason is going to tell you, but obviously this person should be happy, but yet they're not. Obviously this person should be sad, but yet they're not. Why? Because it's all about the thoughts. It's about what's happening inside your head. So your life is a reflection of the thoughts you think. The book of Proverbs says that as a man thinks in his heart, so he is. Not as a man lives. Not as what's happening to a man, so he is. No, as a man thinks in his heart, so he is. And the mistake that we make is we try to control the outside things, which we can't control. But what we don't control is the very thing that we can control, which is the inside things. So we don't spend any time thinking about what we think about. But we spend a lot of time trying to change all of the things over there. So when we look at the problem with pessimism, so pessimism is a person who is just continually critical and they have a negative mindset. And maybe you know somebody like that. They say that there's one of them in every family. So if you can't find the person in the family, then maybe that's you. Maybe you should think about that. I'm only kidding. There isn't one in every family. But we all know people like that. The problem with pessimism and with pessimists is that they tend to view negative events and situations as personal and permanent. So whenever something happens, they take it incredibly personally. It's my fault. Even though they might not verbalize it like that, that's the thought process. I'm no good. I'm a failure. I'm unworthy. I'm incapable of doing anything that's going to make a difference. I've blown it again. It's all on me. But not only do they take it personally, they also think that it's never going to change. It's permanent. Bad things always happen to me. I'm always going to be stuck in this situation. I am the victim. And that pessimistic mindset, if you're taking it personally and you believe that it's permanent, you're going to live that out in your life. So you're going to say, the economy is shot. I'm never going to get the job that I wanted. This virus is unstoppable. We're going to be wearing masks for the rest of our lives. And the world is never going to be safe again. Being content, being satisfied, and feeling blessed, and being optimistic isn't a state of your affairs. It's a state of your mind. So what consumes your mind controls your life. So let me ask you, what is consuming your thoughts? Faith about the future or fear? What if it is fear? What if your mind is filled with dread? What do you do? So the strategy is simple. What you're going to do is you're going to starve your fears and you're going to feed your faith. Because whatever you starve dies and whatever you feed grows. So if you are struggling at the moment and you feel that you are pessimistic, that you are negative and you're not quite sure how to change that, limit your consumption of news. So don't spend your time every single day scrolling through News 24 so that you know, oh, I've read all of the articles today and read every single one. Don't spend hours and hours watching the news broadcasts, because the way that news works, news wants revenue and bad news sells. So what they do, where are they going to weight all of the news? On the shock, on the sensation, on the things that are going to cause dread and anxiety. And when you are filling your mind with that, you're not getting the full picture of what's happening. So you are constantly then going to be reminded of things that are going to grow your fears. So What we want to do, starve that, limit your consumption. And I'm not saying don't know what's going on. Please do. But limit it. Set time and say, I'm going to catch up on the news so that I am aware, but there's the line. If it's 15 or 20 minutes a day. And then you want to be spending time building your faith. So how do we build our faith? We build our faith by immersing ourselves in Scripture. And when I say immersing yourself in Scripture, it's not the same as just reading Scripture. So I've been spending some time going through the Bible. And I'm now in the Gospels, and it's been incredible. I was a little bit overwhelmed because reading through the Old Testament and getting to the Gospels, you feel how big this is, that God has come down to earth. And we've been waiting since Genesis. And all the prophecies are there, and it's been a struggle. And now he's here. And I read the Bible by immersing myself in it. So I put myself in that situation, and I try and understand as much as possible what's going on. And we're busy with our soup project in Motherwell. And we've had people donate 50 loaves of bread at a time. And that's just incredible. So on the day that I'm reading Matthew chapter 14, I come to the church to do some things, and the Motherwell team is here, and they're telling me about the bread that they had received as a donation, the 50 loaves. And I'm like, that's amazing, because I was just reading about bread this morning. And so I shared this story with the people that were there. And it struck me as to how pertinent this is. So what happens is the Lord he's really tired and he's emotionally struggling because his friend John the Baptist has just been beheaded. And that's a whole story all on its own. And he's dealing with that, and he withdraws from everybody. He gets to a place and the crowd hears that he's coming. So they fill out the whole area. And he then steps into a boat and he starts teaching them and he heals them. And it's again taking a lot of effort from him, but he does it because he had compassion on them. He really cared for them. And as he teaches and he heals, and the day is nearly done, the disciples come to him and they say, Lord, we've got a problem here. So it's getting late. And we're going to have to make a plan because the people are hungry. And we can't wait until it's dark because then they're not going to get food. So, Lord, we've come up with a solution. We need to send them back now so that they can go and they can feed. And so the Lord answers, and this verse, when I immerse myself in Scripture, this verse just hits me really hard. Matthew 14, verse 16. The Lord answers and he says, you give them something to eat. And I'm sitting there thinking, okay, hang on. If I was one of the disciples and I've gone to the Lord, and I said, I'm being proactive about this. I'm looking and I'm seeing there's a problem here. I've come up with a solution and I'm saying, Lord, okay, let's send them back. And I tell him and he answers this, you give them something to eat. There's 5,000 of them. That's just not the answer that I'm expecting. And I can see myself standing there looking at the Lord like, I don't know what to say. Like, what's the comeback on that? So they say the practical thing, Lord, we've only got 5 loaves and 2 fish. Like, what you're saying doesn't really make sense. And you know what I love about it? You know why the Lord said that? He said that because he knew what he was going to do. He knew the miracle of how he was going to feed the 5,000 and how everybody would be talking about it for thousands of years, but they didn't get it at the time because they couldn't. And then I feel like maybe we're in that same place. Maybe we're also in that situation where we're saying, Lord, but look at this. Look at what's going on. The world is never going to be the same and the economy's in a mess. But what we don't know is how God is going to use this. How the gospel is being shared in these times. And so when we look at what not just the disciples, but the biblical characters had to go through, sometimes I feel the Lord says the same thing to us. He says something that just makes no sense whatsoever. You go feed them. How? Lord, how are you going to do something good out of this? And he says, just wait. You're going to see. The passage that we've taken, Romans chapter 8, is a beautiful example of that. Because when you immerse yourself into Scripture, you're not just going to go and read that one verse, Romans 8:28, and then you're going to put it everywhere like, oh, God's going to do good things. No, you're going to understand that Romans chapter 8 comes after Romans chapter 7. And you're also going to know that it was Paul the Apostle who was writing to the Romans. And when you look at Paul in chapter 7, you can see, oh, he was struggling. He's literally saying, I don't know. I'm trying to do good, but I keep on doing bad. And the good things that I want to do, I don't do. But all the bad things that I don't want to do, those are the things that I keep doing. And he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who will save me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then he starts Romans chapter 8, possibly one of the greatest chapters in the New Testament. And you know how that starts? There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not set their mind on the things of the flesh, who don't desire worldly things, but they set their mind on things above. And that's where we get life and peace. And those who are led by the Spirit of God, who are thinking about spiritual things, those are the children of God. And then further on in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, Paul writes these words and he says, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Immerse yourself in it. And when you immerse yourself in it, you'll find what Paul means by his suffering, where he was imprisoned how many times? 5 separate occasions, he was whipped 40 times. On 3 separate occasions, he was beaten with rods. And on 1 specific time, they tried to kill him by throwing rocks on him. And they thought he was dead. That's how bad it was. He was shipwrecked in the sea for a night and a day, not knowing, am I going to survive? But God has a purpose. And when you see Paul write about those sufferings and you look at your sufferings and you say, I have to wear a mask. I'm not quite sure when things are going to be normal again. And you start asking, okay, but hang on. What is he trying to tell us here? Because our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that's going to come. What glory? It's that faith view of the future. It's seeing that God is able to use this in the most incredible way. And Paul knew what he was talking about because he had seen it. He had been into the third heaven and seen the glory of God. And he says, but guys, this is not the end. You have no idea how God is going to use all of these tribulations. How are you hurting? What have you lost? How are you experiencing hardships right now? Maybe you are facing a job loss. Maybe you're worried, sick, or battling cancer. Or you have some very serious relational issues. Maybe your marriage is really struggling. Or you're battling with your kids and you've discovered things that you've never known. Maybe a friend has betrayed you, or you're finding it tough to work from home. Whatever it is that you are battling right now, I want you to understand this. The struggle that you are in today is producing the strength that you need tomorrow. And when you see the opportunity that lies within the struggle, you'll understand why Paul says, I glory in my tribulations. Because when I am weak, then I am strong. Because that's when I start relying on God's strength and I start seeing God's plan. And I can't even begin to compare the struggles that we are going through now with the glory that God is going to reveal. That's what Paul reminds us of. That's why we can have an unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for a future good. We're going to starve our fears and we're going to feed our faith. We're going to renew our thoughts by spending time in God's word, not just reading it, but by putting ourselves into it, by living it. Because my life is always moving in the direction of my strongest thoughts. And I want to ask, what do I want my strongest thoughts to be? thoughts about the fact that God is using this. God has always used it, and he always will. And so Paul reminds us in Romans 8:26, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weaknesses when we don't know what we should be praying for. That God's Spirit helps us even when we don't have the words. And that's great news. Because when you feel unsure or incapable or uncertain or worn out, you're not alone. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you. And that same Spirit is the one who is able to comfort you. He is able to bring you that peace. So maybe you are feeling weak and discouraged or overwhelmed or exhausted. And here's some good news. God doesn't help those who help themselves. If you've ever heard that, it's not in the Bible. God helps those who help themselves. It's not there. Do you know who God helps? God helps those who need his help. God helps the weak. God helps the broken, and he helps the desperate. And if you are hurting, then he is your comfort. If you are confused, then he is your guide. If you are discouraged, he's your hope. If you feel anxious, he brings you that peace. And if you feel weak, he is your strength. That's what he promises to do. Because we know that all things work together for those who love God, who are called according to his purposes. And you know, the key to your happiness is not to lower your expectations, as some would say. They would say, if you really want to be happy, just lower your expectations. You won't be disappointed. No. As Christians, do you know what the key is for us? It's not to lower our expectations. The key for us is to raise our expectations and to say, what is God going to do in this time? How is he going to use this in the most incredible way? And we've seen it already in these couple of weeks. We've seen the hand of God at work in our lives. We've seen how he is able to change hearts, where people who were stubborn and hard, who weren't interested, now are asking questions. We've seen people join our online community and ministry. We've seen people within our church step up and say, how can I help? What can I do? So we don't want to say we want to get back to normal. No ways. We want a better normal. We want marriages to be stronger and families to be closer. We want our love for each other to be deeper and our generosity to be greater. As Christians, we want to be bolder in our witness, and we want the light of the church to shine even brighter so that souls can be saved, because that's what God is able to do. And here it is. Do you know what else comes in Romans chapter 8? And this is the part that I really love. So Paul says, we know all things work together for the good. You know why he says that? Because he also wrote the rest of Romans chapter 8. And you know what he reminds us of? Verse 38 and 39. I am convinced, which means I have an unshakable assurance that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. How do you write Romans 8:28? You write Romans 8:28 and you say, God's working all things together for the good. Why? Because he's looking to the future. And he says, nothing will ever separate you from God. So do you know what? It's going to work out. Because God's love is more powerful than anything. And you will never, ever be separated from it. God is going to do exceedingly abundantly above what you could ever imagine. No matter where I go, my God is there. No matter what I do, God still loves me. No matter what happens to me, my God is for me. And that's why I can have an unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our good. Our Christian faith is literally built for this, because it was built on this. It was built on crisis. And the truth thrives in crisis. So we believe not because of what we see. We believe because of what God says. Would you pray with me? Father, the promises that you have given are far greater than anything that we could ever face. But Father, I know that in our weakness, we often allow our minds to drift to those things that are negative. We fill our minds with bad news. But Father, today we have been reminded that there is also good news. And that good news hasn't changed. That good news is the good news that has stood for thousands and thousands of years through crises far worse than this. And Father, in the middle of that, you do your greatest work. And I pray, Father, that we would remind ourselves of that good news. I also know, Father, that during these times, we have the opportunity of allowing our faith to grow. And I want to interrupt this prayer this morning. And wherever you might be, I want to give you something tangible. The scriptures say that those who seek God diligently will find him. That God will honor you when you ask him. But sometimes we never ask. And so this morning, I want to ask you, do you want your faith to grow? Do you want that to thrive? And then all you need to do is just raise your hand. Just lift it and say, Lord, I'm lifting my hand to say, please, let my faith grow. I want to know you more so that I can love you more. And the more I love you, the more I will live for you. Maybe you want to raise your hand in the comments or just type an amen. And as you do that, it's the affirmation that you are serious about this. Maybe you're not too sure about what this good news really is. And that good news is the fact that God has done something about our situation in this world. And it starts with bad news. Because the bad news is that we all sin and fall short. We all do things that we shouldn't do, that we're ashamed of and feel guilty of and embarrassed of. And we try and ignore it and run away from it and pretend like it's not there and put on a show. And that moment when we're ready to be real, we have to confront it. And it's ugly. And God says, but I know it's there. And here's the good news. The good news is he has done something about it. And that's the whole story of God sending his son into the world so that he would die and pay the price for all of that, for all of that bad news in your life. And all he asks is just accept my payment. Just accept that the Lord Jesus Christ gave his life for you. And once you accept that, God does everything else. And that is the good news. He saves you from this world. He saves you for all of eternity. He writes your name in the book of life. And he seals you with his Holy Spirit. You are now his. And that is the start of the greatest adventure of your life. That is news worth sharing and news worth spreading. It's something worthy of being contagious. Father, thank you that we get to look at life differently, that we get to see life from your eternal perspective. And so I pray that you would help us to feed our faith and to grow in our love for you, and that we would love those around us as you have called us to. For our lives are in your hands. The safest and greatest place to be. As we thank you for this in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for joining with us. And for anybody who prayed that prayer and who has given their life to the Lord, please reach out to us. We'd like to be with you on this journey. And so either send us an email, details below. If you're on the Church Online platform, make contact with one of the hosts. And as you do that, we will give you the resources that you need. And we'll help you grow in the weeks and the months that lie ahead. And praise the Lord that we have an unshakable optimism about the future, because our loving God promises to work all things out for the good. May you be blessed as we continue on this journey and enjoy what God is doing.
Of my enemies.